Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to our Link and Learn session on challenges and opportunities of sustainable finance. So my name is Julie Van Kempus, working as a director in the consulting department. And today I'm going to be presenting this session with my two colleagues, Julie Castillo, our sustainability expert, and with Dario Zambotti, my colleague director from our audit department. So now the objectives of this session would be to give you an overview of what ESG mean, in the sense that we hear a lot of different definitions, we hear a lot of different names, and the objective is really to give you more insight on what that means. We'll also provide you some context on the various initiatives related to the sustainable finance as a whole in terms of regulation, but also in terms of market initiatives. We'll also go through some of the expected impacts for the financial sector, and of course, feel free to ask your questions. We'll be happy to answer them after the presentation. So, Dario, maybe can you...
Yes, thank you, Julie. Good afternoon, everybody. Yes, sustainable finance. I think it's really important to set the scene when we discuss about sustainable finance because, Julie, as you mentioned, we are hearing a lot of words and referring to green, social responsible, environmental friendly. But what are we going to talk about this afternoon? First of all, sustainable doesn't mean pro bono or no profit. We're talking about finance, so we want to understand how to implement long-term strategy to get a return, basically. And to set the scene, we can identify three main concepts. We can identify what we call responsible investment. Actually, it's mainly a screening and then excluding some of the specific country or company from our portfolio. So basically, the objective there is to minimize the negative impact. Then we can talk about ESG integration, and here we might identify more type of strategy. We can go from active engagement, so voting and helping companies to get their ESG objective, or to use norm-based screening, so basically to ensure that our portfolio respects some criteria provided by some organization and even benchmarking to some of the index that we see now on the market. And the last and the more extreme, so where we want to really maximize the positive impact, is the impact investing. As auditor, what I've seen in the last years is that some of these strategies have been implemented in UCITS, and mainly the ones that are easiest to be checked from a compliance point of view. So basically exclusion or the norm base. And then for the more alternative structure, what we see is that impact investing, even if it's quite still a niche of market, is growing and normally providing good results. So I think this is just to clarify a little bit what is the arena we are going to move in. And now, Julie, why is it important to discuss this today?
Thank you, Dario. So indeed, during the last few months, you may have heard a lot about this sustainable finance, ESG topics, responsible investment, and so on. And today we are observing three key points of pressure that really lead the market and the development of such a product, such financial product. The first one is clearly the regulation. So as you may know, at EU level, we have technical expert groups that are actively working on the development of specific regulations with the objective to promote and further develop the sustainable finance and to achieve what has been defined by the EU Commission regarding the transition to a low carbon economy and also being more independent in terms of using fossil fuel at European level. The second point of pressure is clearly the investor. The young generation will require more and more investment in what makes sense for them in having an impact, and they will ask their banks and their the asset manager to get information on what is the return on investment, but also what impact are you doing with my money. So young generation will clearly lead also the development of the sustainable finance product. And finally, the market competition. We can observe that more and more banks and asset managers are positioning themselves on the market in developing and promoting such a product. So the market is there, and now is how they will demonstrate how much they are responsible and how much they are able to address the investors' needs. To give you some number on where we stand today, so maybe you know about the principle of responsible investment. It's a United Nations organization, and up to now, 9 in 10 world's largest fund manager already subscribed and demonstrate and signed the UNPRI to demonstrate that they have at least an ESG strategy. Main part of the time is more an exclusion strategy, but it is at least already something. If you are looking at in terms of number, it represents more than 2,000 asset manager, banks, or private equity or real estate institutions that are today signatory of the PRI. For the sustainable finance, in terms of asset under management, it represents 11.4 trillion of euro globally. And at European level, we can observe an increase by 30% of such a product since 2014. Totally, we can observe that 26% of the total professionally managed assets are providing dedicated responsible investing products. So we can observe that it's increasing on the market, and we can observe also a shift from first strategy, it identifies as exclusion, to more handling and to more developing integration of ESG and also making an impact behind that in addition of the return on investment. To have a story of where we stand today, I must say that everything started in 2015 with the Paris Agreement on the climate and the objective of keeping the temperature below the 2 degrees by 2030, and also the definition at the United level of the Sustainable Development Goals that are also to be achieved by 2030. Then the European Commission say, okay, we need to achieve this agreement, and we need also to not only mobilize the institutional finance, but also the private capitals to achieve that. And they have decided in 2016 to design a high level expert group to develop an action plan that was presented at EU level in last year, and the European Commission presented a year ago their action plans for mobilizing and developing the sustainable finance. So up from now, the technical expert group are really working on the key actions that have been identified by the EU Commission, and we are expecting by June to have a final set of documents and regulation that will be amended by 2020 for leading and more developing this type of products on the market.
Maybe something also worth mentioning is that Luxembourg has also launched its own roadmap, sustainable finance roadmap, last October. So there's really a trend to push for more sustainability within the financial sector, for sure.
So on this slide, you can see the 10 actions that have been identified by the EU Commission, and we will go deeper into detail on what impact it will have in terms of regulation in the next slide. But I would like to highlight that the objective is really to reorient the capital flow toward more sustainable investment for achieving the sustainable and inclusive growth. As I said, Europe has set important objective to be achieved by 2050 in terms of reducing the use of the fossil fuel and also going to the transition to a low carbon society. And to achieve this important objective, they need to mobilize the capital market on that. It's also to better manage the financial risk. There is an objective to have a more stabilized market at EU level, and they think and they are convinced that the development of the sustainable finance will allow to better handle the non-financial risk that may have an impact on the financial capabilities, and it will have an impact of a more stabilized market at the end. And also to get more transparency is really a key important concept and word at European level, to get more transparent information provided to the investor and to the market. And that is to avoid what happened 10 years ago with the financial crisis and the lack of transparency. And so this need for transparency is really behind all the regulations that are under development for the moment. So if we have a look at the next slide, you can see the financial figures and why we need to mobilize the capital markets today. So the first part is related to the sustainable development goals, and the second one is related to the Paris Climate Agreement. And you can observe that in blue, it is the current capital flows that are mobilized to achieve these goals. And in green, you can see what is really needed if we would like to achieve that. And so we can see that there is an important effort to be done by the private financial market to invest in this global objective, and to also contribute and to reach that by 2030. If we look at the regulations, for the moment, the EU Commission and the technical expert groups are working on six different types of regulation. Actually, that will be new regulation or existing regulation that will be amended by 2020. The first one is related to the taxonomy, so the classification and the understanding on what is behind sustainable finance. The objective is to ensure to avoid greenwashing and to really identify which type of investment can be considered as green, as having a social impact, and so on. For the moment, the technical expert group is really working on the taxonomy related to climate mitigation. And after, they will move to climate adaptation with the objective to understand, okay, if I would like to invest in green bonds or in a climate mitigation product, what type of investment I can do to reach that. So the technical expert group is developing this taxonomy. The first one will be achieved by June this year, and then we are expecting that the other taxonomy with a main focus on environment will be released in the coming months. Then we have the low carbon benchmark. Is the objective, once again, we are really focusing on the climate, and the objective is to allow the comparability of the performance in terms of climate. The technical expert group working on two types of benchmark. First one is related to a low carbon benchmark, so meaning that what is the activity that demonstrates a low carbon impact. And the other one is related to a benchmark related to the carbon mitigation, meaning that which type of investment are really contributing to reduction of CO2 emission and of the climate impact. This low carbon benchmark information will be helpful for the investor to compare the climate performance of one financial product compared to another, and to lead their decision in terms of impact that they would like to do at the end related to climate. Then, if we look at more niche products, which are the green bonds, at EU level, each country, they have developed their own standards in terms of what is a green bond and what is the criteria behind that. We have also international recognized standards such as the Green Bond Principle of the Climate Bonds Initiative. And the objective of the EU is, once again, to ensure transparency and to avoid greenwashing by defining a standard in terms of green bond. Like this, all green bonds that it will be issued on the at European market level will have the same and meet the same requirement and the same criteria. It will be also once again helpful for the investor to ensure that by investing in such a green bond, they will have the certification that they are contributing to something that is really good for the environment at the end. There is no discussion for the moment to develop social bond standards and so on, but I suppose that it will come in a second step at EU level.
So we see actually that there's a high need for harmonization and standardization in the terms we use, in the types of investments that we have, in order to be on playing on the same level for within Europe. So we see that there's a high effort on that sense, right, Julie?
Yes, indeed. It's really key. The harmonization to ensure that each European country are at the same level on that, because each country, they have their own certification on what is an ESG product, what is SRI, what is an impact investing fund, and so on. And really the objective at European level is not to have 20 type of standards that exist on the market, but only one, providing good information to investors and making sure that it has a good impact at the end, and that we have behind reliable and strong information. And that's also why at European level, they would like to develop more disclosure on impact that are done and on the non-financial performance. For the moment, they have already issued 3 years ago a directive for the large companies to disclose non-financial performance. So the EU Commission, they have disclosed guidelines on what type of information should be disclosed by them, and to also increase the transparency of the information and for allowing stakeholders to better understand the non-financial impact of such companies. No, the objective is to enlarge that to also the financial industry and to have a mandatory reporting process for the asset manager and the management company at the end. The objective is both. For the one that have, for everyone, they will have to disclose what type of strategy are developed internally in terms of sustainable finance. And even asset manager, they have dedicated ESG products, sustainable finance products, and so on. They will have to demonstrate what type of impact they have in terms of environment and social impact. For the moment, we have a lot of discussion around that topic because all the asset management managers and they are expecting to have a better understanding of what will have to be disclosed. How to demonstrate the impact, how to manage the impact, how to find the information, and how it will impact them in terms of workload and in terms of getting the good experts to demonstrate that on the market. So we are really expecting to have the final technical expert group report in June to have more information about who will be targeted by this regulation, and what type of information will be required in order to also, at all levels, to be ready to support our clients to develop their strategy in the good direction. In terms of investor duties and disclosure, there is also a willingness to better include the non-financial risk and mainly the climate risk. 2 years ago, even 3 years ago, The Financial Stability Board, they have designed a task force on the climate finance related disclosure to support a better disclosure of the climate impact and climate risk of the company, and to link this climate risk to the financial capabilities of the companies. And now, at EU level, the Commission decided to consider the recommendation of this task force and to oblige companies, manufacturers, non-financial companies, but also financial institutions, to include this climate risk management and to demonstrate how the climate risk can impact the financial capabilities of their organizations. So that's really important. Now, when we have discussion with our clients and with the financial institution, to let them know that the objective is to increase the transparency and also to better manage the risk and more the long-term risk. Because when we are looking at a climate risk, it can be, for example, if you are investing in the wind turbine and you have in a country that where we will have more flooding and so on, or it will impact the capabilities of the wind turbine to produce renewable energy at the end and to have a good return on investment. So that's really the objective, to have a better, to integrate the external risk within their decision-making process.
So basically, we want to harmonize the way we label our products. We want to make sure that we monitor and disclose the impacts to avoid greenwashing, right? Because for the moment, so maybe some products are labeled ESG or green, but do not necessarily have an impact as they claim to have.
Clearly, when we are looking on the market for the moment, main part of the product that are labeled as sustainable SRI product and so on, it's more or less always exclusion. So that means that they will avoid to invest in tobacco or in the weapon and so on. But it will not be related to the consideration on what impact do I have and how am I selecting my companies to ensure that I will limit the risk. And one important risk is also relating to the reputation. For example, if you are a company and you decide to, if you are a new seed fund and you decide to invest on the important companies on the market and you are not screening them to understand if they have good governance, if they are compliant with the environment, if they are not working with kids and so on, if there is a scandal behind, or you can demonstrate to your investor that your due diligence was aligned to avoid and to understand that that you invest correctly in this company. So that's really the key points: harmonization, transparency, and risk limitation. And for the moment, the main challenge of our clients will really be how to collect this information, to treat this information, and to provide the correct information to the investor to help them to take the good decision to invest in their product instead of the product of the others. And for that, the banks will have also to ask to their investors what are their ESG preferences. So that means that when you will go at your bank level and you will say, okay, I would like to invest to some of your products, your bank will have to ask you, do you have any preferences to invest on environment, on social or governance products? And we assume that, and mainly for the younger generation, they will take care about that. They will not say, oh, I don't care about the environment, I don't care about the society, I want to have the best return on investment, and for the rest, I don't care. We assume that they would like to combine a good return on investment with a positive environmental and social impact. And now the challenge will be how to ensure that, in one hand, the financial institution will be able to understand the investor's expectation in terms of having an ESG product, and secondly, to demonstrate them that they are including their request and that they are able to address their preferences at the end.
So basically, bad news for the financial sector, for the investment firms. After the implementation of MiFID II last year, basically they will have to revise their, for those who haven't done it yet, actually there are some actors already asking for the ESG preferences of their private investors and integrate that within their portfolio. But that means that the investor profile will have to be amended. And of course, the suitability of the portfolio, we also have to include those ESG preferences. And then the same actually for IDD, right? For the insurance distribution directive, they will also have to take the preferences from the ESG preferences from their investors for their insurance policies. So that's also a big change for them to include that. And actually, that's the only way almost to get the funding, the money from the private sector. So this is why the objective is to force the banks to get and the insurance companies to get that money.
And what we realize now is that there is also an education to be done on the market to understand what is a sustainable finance product, what is the sustainable development goals, what is what are the main environmental concerns for today, and so on, because we realize that there is a missing link between what the day-to-day of the asset manager and the financial institution in the way they are developing their financial products, and also difficulties in education of the all the people in the society to understand what is climate change, why they need to act, how they can act, and that their investment has big impact in this in the society as well, and not only their day-to-day behavior. So there is also a key challenge in terms of education, and we can also support our clients in raising awareness, educating them, and also a better communication to their investor to educate them as well. So that's an overview about the main regulation that are under discussion for the moment. In the coming slides, starting on 13, you will have additional information, and I also invite you to have a look at the EU Commission Sustainable Finance website, where you can find all the technical expert group ongoing documents that they already disclosed a few weeks ago, knowing that the final documents should be released by June this year. And at that moment, we need to be ready, and we will be ready for providing additional information to our clients, because we will have more information on the type of impact that it will have. So the coming agenda at EU level is really no, they have closed all the consultation part, so they have released first draft of the document, ask to all the main actors in the financial industry to raise their voice and to tell them what they would like to change. And normally by June this year, we will have all these technical expert group report that will be released. And the various directives as MiFID II, IDD, and the directive on the reporting of non-financial information will be also amended by the end of this year and normally applicable by 2020. So it's really tomorrow.
Very soon, indeed.
Yeah.
I give the floor back to Dario to provide more insights.
Thank you, Julie. Yes, let's take a look to the demand side, because you raised the point on the need of education and the sensibility of the people, of the investors on the matter. And if we refer to a study that was done in 2018 by Schroeder, we can see that 76% of people that were interviewed were already sensible to the matter and ready to invest in sustainable finance. But 25%, however, still have the fear that the objective of a sustainable investment is not really aligned with return. And we will see in a minute that this is absolutely false, and we will explain why. Just to update this study, I mean, we see every day on the news, we see what Greta has brought on the agenda for the powerful people in the world. And just today, European Bank of Investment released a study according to which only 1% of European people are denying the issue of climate change. And apparently, 78% of European people are really alarmed and concerned. What is interesting is to see that also 65% of Chinese are concerned, and 63% of Americans, so US citizens, are concerned, despite the action taken by the government there.
Let's not talk about politics. Right?
No. It's just factual numbers published today. I'm not going to. And again, just to go back to what you raised before, lack of information. Yes, that's the main point raised by the people interviewed in this study by Schroeder. So there is a need of education, there is a need of clarity. So that's why, again, even the demand is asking for harmonization, of the concept and clarity about reporting. So if we go to give a look about the performance of ESG, so actually we can see that literature demonstrate that there is no correlation between negative results and ESG investment policy, and the market is actually demonstrating the opposite. So where you implement ESG factor in your investment strategy, you can deliver a better result, and that's quite easy to look at, because if we consider that ESG is just to make our product, to make our business cycle sustainable, so in long term, that's the best strategy to provide result. So here we explain that ESG actually leads to decrease of exposure to systemic risk, meaning lower cost of capital than higher valuation. That might explain the short term quite easily, but in long term, again, I was just thinking today about this presentation, and if I think about my pension plan, investing with 20-25 years time horizon, of course I would like my pension plan to invest in an ESG strategy first, because I would like to still have a planet where to live in 25 years, and then of course to have return. So I think that the opportunities are really a lot, and can be really achieved by the first movers.
Absolutely. We just wanted with this slide, which do not take it for granted, this is not a scientific analysis of the Luxembourg market. We basically wanted to see for Luxembourg, you know, it's the second largest place in the world in terms of fund domicile. We just wanted to have a look at, do we have today a lot of sustainable funds in Luxembourg? So when I mentioned that it's not a scientific approach, let's say it's more a rough approach by taking checking on the names of the funds. So again, maybe some funds may not be labeled green, but they are. So this is why it has to be taken with some I would say
margin,
yeah. But indeed, we've identified by checking the name for green, sustainable, socially responsible, environmental, climate, we've identified for the moment around roughly 4% of the AUM in Luxembourg would be dedicated to sustainable funds. Meaning that if you take a step back in 2012, we've seen a growth of 180%. So it's growing. Maybe those funds are not would not all 100% fit in the new standardized and harmonized definitions of the commission, but at least there's a will to go for those products. And we see, if you check the names of the promoters or the sponsors on the right side of the slide, we see that some of the actors that are quite active in that area. So we have BlackRock, which is also quite known for their sustainable investment funds. We have Pictet, BNP Paribas, which is also quite big in that area. Conriam, which is a dedicated asset manager. We also wanted to have a look at, okay, we have asset managers, that the pure asset managers, which are Conriam and BlackRock, meaning they do not have this the possibility to direct those funds directly through their to their clients, which is not the case for banking groups. So if you imagine BNP, they launch sustainable funds, they directly have their distribution channel within their group. So we wanted also to show that. It's quite, again, there's room for improvement, there's room for growth. Hopefully, the coming years will see that trend going even faster than expected. But yeah, let's hope that we go there.
we see different players that are positioning themselves expecting the implementation of MiFID II. That's definitely
You mean expecting like waiting or
To be already positioned and to be able to offer the product based on the preference that the investors are going to formalize.
That's a fair point because, okay, there's one thing to oblige banks, or let's say investment firms, to propose those products or to give the opportunity to their clients to have those products in their portfolio, but then that means that they have to have those products, right? So either they launch it themselves, or they look for them. But again, looking for them is not an easy task because of the limited data available and making sure that what you will invest into is actually sustainable.
Yeah, and normally they need also historical performance to market the product.
Absolutely.
And what will be also one of the challenge of the market is really to identify the project on which to invest. With all this taxonomy and new regulation that are happening at EU level, the project, the companies that would like to demonstrate to issue green bonds and to get investment for one of their projects, they will have to align with the taxonomy. So to demonstrate what type of project they have, the type of mitigation that they are doing, that to attract and the investment from the asset manager level. So it will be a really matchmaking process between in what type of project can I invest? Does my investor is really can I reflect my investor needs in the project that I can find on the market or not? As an asset management company, is my process good enough to attract this type of project, or should I revise my standard due diligence process to ensure that I will be able to own a new project to show up to my investor? So it's also a connection. All the procedure will have to be adapted, and it's really also a question of the change in the governance of the financial institution and in the mindset of how it will impact, and it's a different way of investing at the end. So it's all the challenge that for today the market is facing, with not all the answer for the moment, but it will arrive certainly on the market. On the next slide, it is an overview about the main drivers of the sustainable responsible investment demand and the strategy. It's extracted from the last Eurosif study disclosed last year, where you can have an overview about the best market practice and at European level. And so we can see there that the demand is mainly driven by the external pressure, but also the materiality, meaning how can I leverage from non-financial performance also to add financial value to my product. And we can observe also that international initiatives such as the PRI are really key in the pressure of developing such a product. It should be noted that PRI, they have decided to threaten their requirements and to ask to their members to have at least 50% of the total asset under management with an ESG strategy applied. So, and they will also highly recommend to have an external assurance on the information that are provided to them to demonstrate and to once again avoid the greenwashing. So all these external stakeholder international institutions and are really pushing the demand and the development of such a product. And then in terms of strategy, we can see that there is a general transfer of wealth. That means that the new generation will ask more and more for the development and the integration of the ESG strategy within the investment decision process, clearly. And then we can also see that there is a willingness to better contribute to local communities. That's why we can observe also the development of the microfinance product, and also to address climate change. So the climate change is really something that is key for the moment and on which everyone would like to demonstrate contribution. So that's the key lead for the development of such sustainable finance strategy for the moment. So I give back the floor to Julie.
Sure. So in terms of the challenges to expect in the financial sector, I think we've already talked about some of them. The key one would be first the availability of the data. There's still, knowing that there's no standardized or harmonization yet, still difficult to find the data as well, but also to interpret it in a harmonized way. Especially when you talk about direct investments, always difficult to capture the data required. Then another challenge is once you get the data is to make sure you can integrate that into your investment decision process. Whether you stand from a project owner, asset owner perspective, but also from an investment perspective, you need to have to make sure to have the data, or at least the access to the data providers, but you need to have the tools in place to capture it and to monitor it and to analyze it. Well, we briefly mentioned here the repapering of the investor profile, but it's really more related to MiFID and IDD. We can talk about repapering and redocumenting in general, for example, the fund prospectuses. If you want to label it as a sustainable fund, you may want to include the specificities in the prospectus and probably in the KID as well. That is not something we've seen so far, but we can also expect PRIPs to be amended to make sure it includes ESG elements in there. Of course, we mentioned education skills, because of course investing sustainably or analyzing the ESG data requires some expertise, which you might recognize that for the moment in Luxembourg it's quite scarce. One of the reasons is also that we have a limited number of pure asset managers, portfolio managers in Luxembourg. It's also one of the reasons. So do we need to have experts in portfolio in management here in Luxembourg? I don't know, but we definitely need to be able to understand those products because, for example, as a ManCo or an IFM, you need to understand them to be able to oversight to make a proper oversight on the portfolio management activities,
yeah,
and all the rest.
Absolutely, that's key.
That's key.
For the moment, we can observe two types of strategy on the market. Either they externalize the data management process to companies that are really able to process that, to capture the information and provide that to the asset manager, and the decision from the asset manager is done based on the first screening done by the external company, or either they hire experts internally and develop their own methodology to include in their due diligence and to screen and to collect the information and to treat this information. So the both type of strategy for managing data are for the moment under development on the market.
Mm-hmm. And more on a soft skills basis, but also expertise basis. Again, if you are a bank, you want to have your relationship managers or your advisors knowledgeable about those products to be able to sell them to the clients, right? Because mm-hmm. There's this big level of education and awareness that has to happen still. We mentioned also we need to propose the products, but we need to have them. So in order to keep the competitive advantage, we need to be able to differentiate our products or to quickly launch those service the service offering, including ESG. ESG preferences. We see that some actors are dedicated to them. Condriam, we mentioned that a bit earlier. We know that also some actors have also their dedicated sustainable management arm. So this is definitely a trend and showing the need for expertise in that matter. Of course, another challenge, but this is, I would say, our day-to-day job is in integrating and managing the upcoming flows of regulations. Yeah, so first of all, how to integrate sustainability within your organization would be first, of course, to understand where you are, define your strategy, where you want to go. There's the education part, which is going to be key, actually, in every single step of the way. And of course, you need to implement and develop and to put what you want, your strategy into motion. And at the end of the day, one key element would be to demonstrate, meaning disclose the impacts that you had. That's related to the disclosure duties that that Julie was mentioning before.
And what is really important to achieve that is to have a strong governance behind. And when we are on the market, we can observe that board of directors today's are maybe from older generation and not always aware of what will happen, and not always aware, attentive to the new investors' needs. And if we don't have the tone from the top, and to have concrete direction and concrete decision from the board, it will be difficult to achieve. We have a lot of feedback of people that are struggling to develop such a product internally with the board, with a limited understanding, limited knowledge, that say, okay, do it, but I don't want you to take too much time, and they are not believing in that type of product. So there is an important work to be done at the board of director level to inform them that is not it's an obligation first, but it is also and mainly an opportunity, and it's a long-term vision, and that they will have to tackle that if they would like to continue like this. So really, the governance part and the integration of this these sustainability challenges within their investment strategy is really key to achieve that, because otherwise it will remain to have greenwashing and to demonstrate something that is really not really integrated and not really handled internally.
Good. I think we are now arriving towards the end of our presentation. If you have any question, please feel free to type them in, and we are happy to answer them.
We will check for the management of the question.
So we are just checking the question and collecting them. While we are dealing with a small technical issue to identify the question, do not hesitate anyway to contact us, even by email after this presentation. We will be happy to come back to you. You have the details on the presentation. Actually, the slides will be available after 24 hours after this session via the link that was provided in the email of the invitation.
You might want to just chat, I think, so that they can send a mail after the presentation.
Okay.
Should be the best way, I think.
Okay, so we thank you for your attention. We were happy to share with you those insights on challenges and opportunities of sustainable finance. And we hope that we will be in contact for the next webinar and to have the occasion to meet again online. The next Link and Learn will be on the 25th of April on investment management funds. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.